to all of my BPTV fans, Facebook fans, and YouTube fans. I'm Alan Levine, the talking machine. I'm honored to be interviewing an NFL great and an author. And this is my 60th Talking Machine show. I have another great guest. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Steve Wright. Living in Malibu, California, former NFL player of 11 years, last seven out here with the Los Angeles Raiders, created the sideline misting company called Cloudburst and Cool the Olympics, and the new published author of Aggressively Human, which just came out about 3 weeks ago. I was the number one. It was the number one new release for sports biographies and memoirs. So I'm super proud of it. I recorded the Audible, had a lot of fun with it, and I appreciate you, Alan, getting me on here and allowing me to talk about it.
Well, you're so welcome. I bleed black and gold like I talk to you, but I am honored that you had 7 years with the Raiders. You actually were with the Cowboys. You know how hated those teams are in Pittsburgh. And you were also with the Colts. So yes. I'm honored and blessed to be able to do this with you. We have a lot to talk about it, and we got 29 minutes, and I know we can handle it all with my new author friend. All right, I'm ready to do it. Yeah, first off, where were you born?
I was born in, we're starting at the beginning. I was born in St. Louis, Missouri. Yes. My father was with a company for 30 years. I was born in St. Louis, Missouri. He got transferred to Minneapolis, then out to Connecticut, to Chicago, and then a few more times around the Minneapolis area until I was out of high school. Went to University of Northern Iowa in Cedar Falls, Iowa, to college, play football, and then the Dallas Cowboys found me from there and went off to Dallas and started my pro career.
Well, you saved a bunch of questions. I'm not going to ask each school where you went because the list would be too long for this show. But you were a traveling man there with your dad and family. Do you have any brothers or sisters?
I do. I've got a younger brother and an older sister. And I'm a real extrovert, make friends easy. And I think that came from my upbringing. As soon as I would settle in with a new tribe of buddies, we were up and gone. And so I just learned to adapt quickly. My wife says my animal spirit is a golden retriever, which I love golden retrievers. I've been through about six of them.
No, that's very apropos. I grew up with black Labradors. So another great friendly dog.
They're awesome too.
Yeah, my 60-pound, I named him Bingo back in the 60s. He helped me deliver papers, and he'd sit in my lap like a little cuddle puppy, and he was like 70 pounds, and I was just a 12-year-old boy then, so great memories.
That's awesome. Love those stories.
Well, when did you start playing sports?
Started, probably hockey was my first sport in Minneapolis.
Playing hockey.
I think I had my sister's figure skates and bundled up like a big marshmallow and knocking the puck around, and then kind of morphed into basketball and baseball and a little bit of football in fourth grade. I started full contact in fourth grade with football. And
did you come from an athletic family like I did?
I did not. My father played some basketball with the Marines. In Camp.
Thank you for his service. Thank you for his service.
He was, so that's where he met my mother in Camp Lejeune.
Is
that South Carolina, North Carolina? So just playing all the sports, which I just really wish younger kids could do. I have quite a few friends and they're really buttonholed into playing one sport.
Steve, I agree wholeheartedly with it. Doing my, sports show, Pittsburgh Sportsline, we talk about all the time, just the things that you learn in other sports that can tie in with each one. plus the shape that you're in, right?
And just the new buddies and the new tribes, and trying new sports. It would baseball would work on maybe your hand-eye coordination, and
yes,
football, each sport brought a different learning experience, and I just really covered it. At high school, I did shot and track. I was an All-American.
You were All-American?
I was a high school All-American in shot put and discus.
Wow, you must have been a strong, athletic guy.
I was, yeah, sure.
Throwing shot put.
6'5", I think about 225 in high school, my senior year.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was only 6'1", 195, and I was a center. I had to go up against all those big guys, 250 to 300. So
yep.
I took and a I beating, but I took a pound of flesh a lot of the time. So
made you who you are.
Believe me, I tell everybody, and I know you believe it, if you have sports in your life growing up, it teaches you so many fundamentals that can help you in business, life, and everything else. And I honor my coaches, especially from high school, for training me to be the man that I am.
Exactly. Not giving up, giving your best effort, being on time.
Yes.
Just some real simple golden rules. Besides just working with people that you just do not like. I always, say that with in my pro career, I had teammates that I just did not like, but if they were in a fight, I was going to be the first one over the top of the back of them to pound on who's ever,
working over
one of my teammates.
And when you play a team sport, you learn all the different things and facets of other people and nuances that they have. They're maybe not like you at all or your family, what you grew up with, but you have to play with them. So you sort of learn to have an open mind.
Sure. You have to. And I in my book, I talk about just the locker room was the racial utopia. It was there was no skin color or nationality or anything else. Man, we were all just a bunch of brothers. It's beautiful bringing all mixes of life together to be a team.
You're hitting with the chords with me. Like when I grew up, I didn't see color and I didn't care about color. I didn't even speak about it, and I knew people were different. But guess what? We were all together, like you say, a brotherhood. And it truly resonates today with all the discourses going on now. It truly does. I always ask, where's common sense, Steve? That's my main question.
Yeah. Compassion and empathy too. And,
amen.
Yeah. I'm actually looking forward to the football season being over and start really pushing my book into more,
let me go to football before we go to your book. What year were you drafted?
I was a free agent in 1981 with the Cowboys, myself and two others.
Okay.
Three free agents made it out of 120 my rookie year.
You're kidding. What a number. So you must have been pretty good.
I was, I call it a wood tick. They couldn't get rid of me. I hustled beyond hustle. I thought ahead. I did a lot of little things that meant a lot.
What I tell young people, you want to make yourself indispensable in a job or a sport. And then they can't get rid of you. So you sound like the guy that I've tried to inspire others with in my life. So that's so cool. 3 out of 125. And what position was it, so we can tell our fans here?
Offensive line.
Nice.
Offensive tackle. Offensive tackle mostly, but I played right guard in Minnesota my rookie year for the longest run in NFL history with blocking for Tony Dorsett.
Guess what? Local Pittsburgh guy. I met him here when he was in college.
Oh, sweet.
Him and Dan Marino. I met him back then. I hung around the Pitt campus, so I knew of him, and friends of mine were in classes with him. And they told me about Danny Marino and Tony Dorsett. They didn't see them in classes much.
Oh, is that right?
Just had to share that.
And they both came out okay.
Yeah, I was going to say it didn't matter. Look at the careers and then the lives they had after, since it. Then they're both Hall of Famers.
Yeah. And that's part of my book too, is, you know, finding something. If something hits your gut and it's perfect and you want to run with it, go. And theirs was football.
Yes.
And so their focus was on football and not trying to make the dean's list.
Exactly. If they could, they would. But I understand sure. that mentality. A lot of people can't relate to it today because they say all about college and make sure you do all of this. And then you see there's different issues with that alone. But it's a different time.
Different strokes for different folks. You just got to do what's right for you. Yeah.
And did you win a Super Bowl with them?
I did not. I like to say I was at 6 Super Bowls and I had really good seats at all those games.
I like that. We'll get along perfectly. But, carry on.
I lost. I was in 3 championship games, 2 with the Dallas Cowboys in my early days and then once with the Raiders. We lost all 3 of those. So, no, missed Super Bowls, but got an 11-year career and got out healthy.
Right. What was it like, you know, since I bleed black and gold, what was it like playing and living in Dallas for you?
Dallas was beyond Disneyland for a young kid with some money in his pocket. The show Dallas was just starting there. The oil was booming.
Oh, good point. Yeah.
The city was on fire with partying. Their motto was work hard and play hard. Every night at 5 o'clock, all the bars were full for happy hour until about 7 o'clock. So
wow.
It was just it was mayhem for a young 21-year-old playing in Dallas in those days.
It looks like you handled it and survived it though.
Yeah, I did. And it's some funny stories in my book about it.
No, that'd be great. Can you share one with us that's maybe family-oriented in a sense? Because we don't do any swearing or anything like that, but, you know.
Yeah.
I wanted to pull one out of you there, author.
Sure. Let's see. I tell a funny one. We used to have pool parties on Saturdays. I lived in a complex. There was about 5,000 single people all working downtown Dallas. And on the weekends, we would just tear it up. And we were doing it one weekend. And the police broke the party up. I had left earlier with my girlfriend. I walked up about 11 o'clock at night. And I see a bunch of cops all squatting down and watching my apartment. And I tiptoed up and said, "Hey, what's going on?" And I ended up getting arrested. I was stone sober.
Oh my goodness.
Just that kind of shenanigans was going on week after. I mean, just it was just the way of life in Dallas in the early 80s.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that there. I appreciate
That wasn't a good one, but there's plenty of others.
We can talk off air about that. I'd enjoy about an hour session with you, at least. I know you got some good stories, especially being in the football world. And then you played how many years with Dallas? 4 years?
2 years.
Two years.
Okay. I got traded going into my third season to the Baltimore Colts, and then played 1 year there with them, and then went with them to Indianapolis. So I just got invited back to Indianapolis for the 40th reunion of the
Congratulations.
Colts. Yeah. It was great. A lot of great teammates. The worst coast with Frank Cush was our coach, who was just a mess and a half. But I made it through, and that got me to be a starter immediately instead of backing up for the next couple of years with Dallas. So
well,
I got
way
the
to
start.
Go, then. And that's improve, great.
Yeah, improve my skills. Yeah.
All right, then. I'm trying to walk you through the block with where we're going because we're going to get to that author in a little bit. So how many years with the now Indianapolis Colts?
I was with the Baltimore-Indianapolis Colts for 2 years, one in Baltimore, one in Indy, and then the Ursays were the lowest-paying team in the NFL.
Yes.
I ended up getting courted by the Oakland Invaders of the USFL, so I easily and quickly jumped leagues for 3 times the amount of money and landed in Oakland.
I was going to say, you went for the money. Yeah.
Sure. Because once I got traded from Dallas, I realized that, hey, I'm not this football player. I'm just a product. So this product's got to look out for himself, and that's going to take wherever the money is and wherever the best contract is and where my heart is being pulled.
Sure.
And so, sure. Yeah, so I ended up with the Oakland Invaders. We played 1 year of the championship game. We lost. The league folded. And right. Our head coach had been the defensive coordinator for the Raiders for the previous 10 years, Charlie Sumner. So he brought myself and Anthony Carter down to Los Angeles to try out.
Yeah. Nice. No, and in the meantime, did you get married and have kids or anything during that time, too?
I didn't. Nope. I was always going to hold off on marriage, as hard as it was a few times.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking. Yeah.
Yeah. I read about that as well, too. Just mentors. And it wasn't a conducive place for a solid marriage. Being a young guy playing in the NFL, there's just... if you got oats to sow, there's an oat field out there that
I'm noticing just, you had some wisdom and you're moving around every couple years. So I notice a pattern, 2 years here, 2 years there. Now, when did you get with the Raiders since now you're in Oakland?
1987, I came down to play with the Raiders. The league folded up with the USFL in 85. Basically, right. Almost a whole year off to get situated and back down with the Los Angeles Raiders to start the year, and then we started with a strike.
Yes,
so my first attention to business was walking the picket line for a month.
Wow, what a story! Well, I'm a union guy, production worker from the Pittsburgh Post Gazette and Pittsburgh Press. I got in 1975. And before my birthday on June 30th of 75, we were on strike for a month. The Teamsters went on strike. So I go, wow, that's crazy. I'm not even here a year, and there was a strike back in 75.
Yep.
So, yeah, I understand more than you would know about watching a picket line.
Sure. I did it also in Dallas in 82 when we struck.
Okay.
So my career, I was watching picket lines two different times.
Wow, very interesting. Yeah. Being an NFL player there,
and you pay your dues. Yeah, you pay your dues, and you are a product. So, you know,
right?
How do I take care of myself?
Well, exactly right. And you know, you're an athlete, and you're getting paid to do it. So that's a dream come true for me as a child. Let alone with what you did, right?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So, yeah. Now you lasted how many years there with the Raiders?
Seven. I retired. Okay. I retired the year they moved back up to Oakland. I was finishing my career. I had a business opportunity that I'd already been working on for a couple of years, my sideline mist cooling business. And so when they moved up to Oakland, I retired at 35 years old, incorporated my company called Cloudburst, and just dove into that head first. And 2 years later, cooled the 96 Summer Olympics off. And
now, tell them what that business is. We got a couple minutes.
Sure.
We can talk about that.
Sure.
Because that's a fascinating business.
It's the sideline mist cooling fans that you see cooling the NFL sidelines. I brought that to the NFL in 1990 with the Raiders.
You're the guy. You're that guy. Wow.
I saw an opportunity. It was it was basically kind of like every business starts, you know, like Gates starts in a garage. Everybody starts small without the real intention of blowing this thing up.
Right.
So I got this idea from Palm Springs. We cooled our sidelines, and then other places wanted it, like Hollywood Park Racetrack, the horse racetrack.
Wow,
they wanted to cool their horses off. And so it turned into a killer business. I ended up getting into 1,500 Home Depots and Lowe's and Costco's.
You just blew me away.
Walmart.
Wow.
It really took off. And I had 40 SKUs in all those stores, so all the different pieces and parts. And I ended up cooling the Olympics, and I've had the things on aircraft carrier decks, every place where, you know, an air conditioner was needed.
What didn't you cool down? And I owned racehorses in the 80s, so I had standard breds. I understand about cooling them down in the hot summers. So
well, it was
resonated
it was also
with
too,
me.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. At Hollywood Park, they'd walk around with the hoses and hose down the dirt so it wouldn't kick up and it would make it all muddy. I had these on for 10 minutes every hour. They would put out this high pressure. And so besides cooling the air, it's going to settle all the dust and it scattered all the flying insects. All the flies were gone. And it just turned the air in the stable into, you know, really fresh.
No, that is super. And I actually, you know, saw things like that in our studio, you know, our barns and stuff at the Meadows right here outside of Pittsburgh for years.
Very cool.
That is so cool. Sweet. No, it's amazing what you did starting at 35. And you still own the business or did you sell it? Or
I don't. I sold it to him and my partner in like 2000 and just got into other things to keep me busy. I've got a patent on a toilet that I discovered that I'm working on selling that thing now. Just always kind of just enjoy just keeping the brain moving and looking for opportunities that will either help me or help others.
No, that
there's
is
so
great.
Many ideas out there. Yeah.
You got a very active mind and you've done a lot of things, but we're running down that we got about 8 minutes and I wanted to bring up you were on Survivor also.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How did that come
I was
about?
On I was down at Fox Studio with my old teammate Howie Long. I go down there maybe once a year.
Now that's a nice name to drop, Howie Long.
Yeah. He supported, he's on the cover of my book. He endorsed it and yeah, he's been a real great friend for a lot of years. Where was I going with all that?
No, we can read the book. Now we're going, I wanted to segue to the book. Tell them the name of your book.
Yeah, the name of the book is Aggressively Human. But I guess to finish that story, Jimmy Johnson had been on Survivor the year before. And so he had the lead casting director there, and we talked, and she talked me to try it out, and I ended up in Nicaragua, lost 33 pounds in 31 Whoa. Days, and then had to get my front tooth extracted because it had so much bacteria in it. Quite an experience that I did not want to go back to when they called again. But the book is Aggressively Human.
There we go. Hold that up for another second. Yeah, hold that book up again. Buy this book. Where can they buy it?
They can buy it, I think, about 30,000 different places, honestly. But it's, you know, go to Amazon. I've recorded for Audible, which was a lot of fun. But it's the ebook, the Kindle, the hard and soft cover. You can go to my website, which is writeauthor.com, W-R-I-T-H-T, author.com. It's got all my blogs I've been posting every Sunday morning for the last half a year.
And, nice.
A bunch of photos sitting there with Bo Jackson or Howie and just it's a fun website.
What inspired you to write the book?
I've got a lot of fun stories. I've always thought about doing it for at least the last 10-15 years. And the pandemic kind of presented an opportune time and I just started writing, and the theme of the book and the name of the book, the title, that all kind of came 3/4 of the way through it. Just learning, I was really always kind of battling with being humane, being passionate, being compassionate, empathetic, but then having to turn on the beast for sports from, you know, early high school years of playing hockey to. And then what's happening now is now that the season is nearing the end, I'm going to start spreading out my message to everything from Republicans and Democrats or mask or no mask or Palestinians or Jewish or everybody's fighting about something. And it's not a healthy conversation ever with any of them. Nobody's listening. No one's being compassionate to hear the other person speak. And so it's driving crazy. So I think I'm kind of getting funneled into my next approach is kind of trying to tame the volume a little bit between listening and being compassionate and understanding of others.
And my mother taught me as a young boy to be kind because she said, Alan, you don't know what other people are going through, so just be kind.
I wear a t-shirt that says that across the back, and on the front of it is be kind.
Well, I had a feeling that we were similar like that with what you're saying, because just
right
the word
that.
Empathy today, There's a disrespect for that when you have empathy.
It sure is. It's crazy, and it's just getting worse, and it just doesn't take much to set somebody off. Just in the grocery store or something, or you're both going for the same parking spot. It doesn't just, well, pardon me, it gets ugly. And it's just like, wow, people are just living on the edge of, you know, a lot of hate. And then on top of that, then you've got a record amount of guns out there. And it's just it's a bad recipe. But something that's a lot simpler, that's a lot more practical, that's a lot more in your face, is 99% of Americans have not seen a person that's been shot. Until that is shown, it's still going to be going on, this fighting. But once you see the damage that a gun has done to a small person, or even a grown up, and show it and put it on the front pages of the papers, that'll stir people for a change. Like, if they say a photo is worth a thousand words, and all the BS of, oh, we're living our prayers and we want to lift them up and do all show what it's done. That'll rock the world out of people.
Steve, that's a great point, because we're desensitized by all the violence we see. And you're so right when you show another human.
But nobody sees it. But nobody sees it. You hear about it. Oh, we have this mass shooting.
That's a great point. Yes.
You always have this mass shooting, and then 3 days later, it shows them all smiling at birthday parties. Wait a minute. No, that's not how they were left.
You know? Right.
It just really roils me.
Well, they miss the point that grief lasts a lifetime. It's how you deal with it. And that's how I am. Hey, we're running short on time, because you and I both can talk prolifically. And I got about a minute and 20 some seconds. How would you want to inspire others to be successful in life?
I think grab it and shake it. If there's an opportunity in life, no matter what it is, and it feels good in your gut, our gut has been developed over a million years of evolution. If it feels good, go for it. You might run into a wall, but it might set you into survivor, or it might set you into launching a monstrous business, like my Cloudburst. Opportunities. I just don't want to end life by saying coulda, woulda, shoulda. If there's an opportunity, you live in this life once, you don't know when it's going to end, grab it, have some fun with it, do what you can with it, look for opportunities, and be kind to people. And it comes back to you tenfold.
Well, thank you very much. What I'm hearing from you is, don't live with any regrets in your life.
Yeah.
Just do it like Nike says, and I've done it. That's why I'm doing this great show with you. I'm honored and blessed to have had another great guest, and I thank you so much, Steve. We're going to have to shut this show down, so thank you again, and I appreciate Neil Haley giving me an assist, meeting a good friend of mine now, Steve Wright.
Right on. Thank you, Alan. I really appreciate being on your show and being able to promote my book and just have a nice conversation with you. Thank you.